Can you hear me, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, I'm going to divide it into two different parts. This is going to be a craniofacial session from today. And I have my good friend and an excellent craniofacial surgeon, Professor Ramesh Sharma, is going to take over from me from tomorrow. Before that, he is going to talk on specific topics. Therefore, I thought I will just give an introduction to craniofacial surgery as such. What all form craniofacial surgery and the basic principle in the management of synostosis. So the part one is this. Now what all form the craniofacial surgery? Can you see all?
Yes, sir.
It can be a malformation or tumor. It can be fibrous dysplasia. It can be meningoencephalocele. Or it can be rare clefts. It may be from a small cleft there or a groove to the cleft in the lip, a cleft in the nose in the form of a groove or a small notch, or a major nasal and central portion of the cleft, or a macrostoma, or four or five clefts which are going oro-ocular clefts. Any of these clefts also come under this. Then synostosis and craniofacial dysostosis syndromes. Then there is a heterogeneous group of anomalies with multiple causes which cannot be classified as one. Now, how does it take place? There are multiple pathways in it. There may be a genetic factor, a cellular abnormality it gives rise to. The same genetic factor can also give rise to deformational forces, or it can be a secondary effect of some other problem. Cellular abnormality, all of them can give rise to synostosis. So synostosis is something where there may be multiple pathways in which it happens. Now I'll come to some basics in a diagrammatic way. Now let us imagine there is a cell. The cell proliferates. Then the cell differentiates into ectoderm, endoderm, and mesenchymal cells. Then you see that they migrate against each other, and as they meet, there is cell death. Once there is cell death, they fuse together. Once they fuse, the mesenchyme proliferates from either side and then forms a structure, and the structure grows. So anywhere in this pathway, there may be problem in proliferation. There may be problem in differentiation. There may be problem in migration or fusion, mesenchymal proliferation, or growth which may be excess or less than what it should be. So any of these things can give rise to the problem. Now you can draw a line in that. One can be called as abnormal development. So the developmental itself is abnormal. That is proliferation, there is a problem. It is usually dysmetabolic. If there is a problem in differentiation, you call it as malformation. When there is a problem with migration, then you call it as dysplasia. All of them are abnormal development. Now, next half is the development is normal, but there is an alteration in the development. First one, the development itself is not there. Second one, development is there, but there is an alteration. Like, let us say, the mesoderm proliferates, mesenchymal proliferation is there. But what happened? There is no fusion at all. Or there may be a disruption of the fusion which has taken place. This is very common. You see in cleft palate, mesenchymal proliferation, ruptures are there. Then it gives way on forming clefts. Then it may be formed totally, but another force from below or by the side or on it may compress it and disrupt the whole process. That we call as a deformational. Then if all these things are normal, then there is a growth which has to take place. The growth doesn't take place. So you have hypoplasia or aplasia or hyperplasia. So you understand this metabolism. Malformation, if there is a differentiation problem. Migration problem is dysplasia. or cell death happens, but there is no fusion taking place. This is alteration in normal development. There can also be a disruptive force or a deformational force, or there may be excess or slow amount of growth taking place, hyperplasia, aplasia, or hyperplasia. Now we'll go this way. Abnormal development. So usually this is inborn error in metabolism. They are very uncommon. We don't see that commonly. Hurler's syndrome along with synostosis. But the malformation is something which is more common, wherein the tissues are not differentiating into various components of a structure. This can be an agenesis or redundant morphogenesis or developmental arrest. All these three can take place. Let's say for an example, agenesis. Supposing the brain itself doesn't develop totally and there is no fusion between the two lobes, you get what is called as holoprosencephaly, where it is the whole thing is into a single mass, and there may be along with that cyclopia, single eye. Or it may be redundant, as you see here, a duplication of the nose. Second thing can be a developmental arrest. That can be a hyperplasia, as I told you, or non-fusion, as I told you, like cleft lip and palate, or suppression of the migration, as you see in the case of encephalopathy. Abnormal development, when we say, one more is the dysplasia. What happens is, either the epidermal, mesodermal, or endodermal structure are abnormal in its development. Very uncommon, but you see the nevi, which are there in the scalp, which you see commonly linear sebaceous nevi, they all come under the dysplasia syndromes. Alteration in the normal development. Now, first one is all those where there is an abnormal development. Now, here normal development alteration. What happened? Let us say there is an amniotic band that is compressing on the already developing finger. Then you get what you call as the transverse arrest of these fingers, or you can call it as ring constriction syndrome. Same way you can see, it can also produce a cleft there. You can see here the line. It can be oro-ocular, oro-nasoocular, any of those depending upon the position of the amniotic band. Then forces from some other reason, let us say the position or the placenta or some other amniotic band, they deform the existing situation, like you see here in torticollis, or you can have in the case of a plagiocephaly, or there is in the case of scoliosis, which is congenital. All these are deformed, but the structures are there. Spine is there, the skull is there, the neck is there, but all of them are pushed to one side or other. And also it is usual in the case of peri-Raman sequence. I'll come to that later. Then what we call as craniofacial microsomia. This is the correct terminology to use. First and second branchial arch syndromes are these. All structures developed from these may be abnormal. Olden days we used to call it as hemifacial microsomia. When you say hemi, it means only one half. But in these cases, it is not one half. It may be on both sides. So it is variously named as dysostosis, otomandibularis, that means ear and mandible, auriculobranchiogenic dysplasia, or oromandibular auricular syndrome. It is nothing but telling you the ear is involved, the mandible is involved, and the oral is involved. Since it can occur bilaterally, do not call it as hemifacial microsomia, even if it is on one side. You call it as a craniofacial microsomia, unilateral or bilateral. You may miss some of the minor deformity on the opposite side. That's why it is safer for you to call it as craniofacial microsomia rather than hemifacial microsomia. You've got three components in this. An auricular component, a mandibular component, and a maxillary component. You see here, the ear alone is deformed. You can see here, ear, you can see in the same picture, same bar you can see here, the maxilla and mandible are also on one side, it is abnormal. It may also involve the adjoining structures of zygoma, the nose, or even the facial nerve and masticatory muscles. In many cases, you may find jaw may be more pronounced, but if you look carefully, you see here there is a small cystic sinuses and cysts in the ear. These are that he will tell that it's a mole which has been there right from birth. So the ear is minor, but the jaw is predominant. In another case, you will find the ear is predominant, but the jaw you can see here is minor. So it is not necessary all the three component, maxillary, mandibular, and auricular component must be prominent. It can be one prominent and the others are not. In severe cases, all structures developed from first and second branchial arches are involved. But in others, it is not so. Now you look at this case. I have not put the X-ray because it is very difficult for you to see in the X-ray. This girl came with only the auricular problem. But when you took an X-ray, you realize that there is condyle involvement in the X-ray. So all cases of external auditory canal and mid-ear involvement show always changes in the mandible. It may be minor. So you look for it, external auditory canal and middle ear development is bad, then you will find, look for a mandibular problem. Ear may be less severe, as I showed you, and you may have just a question of, I must say, the incisor gap may be more than normal, or there may be the occlusion. When you ask them to see, you will find the inter-incisor line is not in alignment. So that also forms a first and second branchial arch. Then there is a thing called as a forms frustrate. That means there is a frustration in forming. So it attempts to form, it gets frustrated. And ultimately, even though it forms, you will find there may be a dermoid, there may be a hollowness in the cheek. All these called as the first and second branchial arch syndrome. You can see here in this boy, it is only the left side of the face. From childhood, you find it is hyperplastic compared to the opposite side. Then Treacher-Collins syndrome. Why I am talking about Treacher-Collins after this craniofacial is, always we may get confused between the two. It is a disorder transmitted through autosomal dominant gene. It is almost always bilateral. Craniofacial microsomia can be unilateral. Here, it is almost always bilateral. The current concept is, it is the failure of the migration of the neural crest cells from the posterior aspect. See, it fails to penetrate. It fails to migrate to the branchial arches. That is why you have the Treacher-Collins syndrome. What are the important features? There is an anti-mongoloid slant. There is a coloboma of the lower eyelid. You have an absent eyelashes in the medial two-third. Zygomaticomandibular hyperplasia, auricular defect, and anterior place sideburn. Cleft of 6, 7, 8 may be present. I will show you in a close-up the next picture. Out of this, we call this as the obligatory features. Majority of these obligatory features must be there for you to call it as Treacher-Collins syndrome. Number one is anti-mongoloid slant. Number two, coloboma. Number three, absence of eyelashes on the medial two-third. Number four, zygomaticomandibular hyperplasia. You can see here the hollowness very nicely, both the sides. An anteriorly placed sideburn, and there may be a micronatia. You remember it is micronatia, the ramus is normal. It is only the anteriorly it is pushed back, the vertical ramus and body are all right. So out of these obligatory, if majority of them are present, then only you can call it as tetracholine syndrome. The other frequent features are there, I'll skip that. The skeletal defect, when you take an X-ray, you will find the orbit oval and it is inclined outward. The supraorbital margin is sloping down. There is usually a large defect in the flow. The zygoma is rudimentary, almost nothing is there. Anteriorly and laterally placed maxilla, which is flat. So see here the sloping, the orbit is oval and outward and downward, defect in the floor, zygoma is rudimentary, maxilla is flat. How to differentiate? Your bilateral craniofacial microsomia from tetracholine or mandibulofacial dysostosis. The mandibular ramus malformation and facial palsy, if present, cannot be tetracholine. So look for the ramus must be normal. Condyle is usually normal. And if there is facial palsy, it cannot be tetracholine. And out of the six what I told, majority of the obligatory features must be present for you to call it tetracholine. Otherwise, you must call it as craniofacial. Hemifacial microsomia instead of that craniofacial microsomia. Then come to Romberg disease. Romberg disease is nothing but a progressive hemifacial atrophy. It is not a congenital condition. It is sporadic. Familial cases show no clear-cut mode of transmission. You can't say autosomal or it is six chromosomes, but you see it starts late. It is not congenital, and only one side of the face is involved. Atrophy normally begins, you can see here, by 20 years of age. Initially, it is the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Later on, the muscle gets involved. Sometimes even the bone may get involved. In 95% of the cases, it is unilateral. There is always a pigmentary change of the hair, and there may be skin, and also the iris may get pigmentary changes. It may be brownish at spots. Some of the areas may be brownish compared to the surrounding area. And the hair also may show discoloration or grayness. And skin may also show depigmentation or hyperpigmentation. The next one is Pierre-Robin sequence. Olden days we used to call it as Pierre-Robin syndrome or anomaly. Now we call it as a sequence. Why it is called as sequence? It is malformation together with subsequent derived structural change. So something is deforming it. So then you cannot call it purely as an anomaly or malformation. It is not a genetic syndrome. Actually, one anomaly leads to other changes. So first, initially, it's an anomaly. Later on, that anomaly produces the deformation. Let us look at it this way. You can see here the tongue. It gets pushed up. When it gets pushed up, the two palatal shelves are unable to meet and there is a cleft. So cleft is not due to disruption. Cleft is due to because the mechanically something is stopping it. Now you look like this. Supposing the down or there is an acute flexion. What happens is this gets pushed against the knee much more. That pushing off that mandible produces a glossoptosis that prevents the vertical palatal shelves from closing, and that is why the also looks smaller. it is not necessarily the jaw becoming hypoplastic. It is more a sequence. There is a glass. First, there is an anomaly. That anomaly leads to glossoptosis. That glossoptosis pushes it upward. That glossoptosis pushing it upward prevents the palatal. It is not something to do with palate, not something to do with the chin. It is because of the anomaly taking place around the tongue. Remaining things are sequences of that. Supposing that, let us say the jaw is lifted up, then it will not happen. So jaw gets pushed, then the anomaly takes place. Binder's syndrome is the next one. Here there is a problem confined to nasomaxillary or nasoethmoidal region. It is divided into two groups, with or without dento-alveolar involvement. Commonly we say binders when there is not much of an alveolar involvement. That can also be with a normal length of the nose or a foreshortened nose. Usual features are retruded nose, low set flat tip, crescent shaped nostrils, short retracted columella, acute nasolabial angle, minimal or missing sill, wide shallow philtrum. The philtrum is from here to here, wide shallow philtrum. Occasionally it is, he described it in 1962. Then lastly, when we talk about fibrous dysplasia, this is an abnormal proliferation of bone forming the mesenchyme. So it is the mesenchyme is abnormally proliferating. So it is almost in the first stage itself. From cell to proliferation, it is happening, the mesenchyme. The main differential diagnosis for that is Paget's disease. It may be monoostotic, that means one bone, or polyostotic, as you see here, multiple bones. The common area involved are frontal, ethmoidal, sphenoidal, and orbit. You can see here all these. They are classified as, when you see X-ray wise, pagetoid. When you say pagetoid, it contains both the sclerosed area and the translucent area. Then you call it as pagetoid. Or you get only sclerotic or homogeneous density. Or the third one is cystic variety, where everything is just cyst. Now this is important for you when you are reshaping it. You will find this sclerotic one is difficult, but the pagetoid and the cystic one will give way and there will be defect. Because of your reshaping, you may enter into getting into the cyst and then abnormality will be there. You may have to add some bone grafts there. In the case of a pagetoid, majority of the time, you will be able to just bury it off or shave it off. Lastly, a small clue on how to identify the various numbers of the cleft. I have a method which I thought may be useful to you. Just remember, everything is in threes. And the fourth one is the junction. Now you look at this. Everything from 1 to 2 and 3 are within the nose. Close to the septum is 1, nearer the cheek is 3, in the center is 2. So 1, 2, 3 are in the nose, 1 is near the septum, 3 is near the base, 2 is in the center. Fourth is the junction between the nose and cheek. Same way, 5, 6, 7 are all in the cheek, so all of them are outside the nose. So nose is not involved in this, right? 5, 6, 7 are in the cheek, 7 is at the end, 5 is in the middle of the eye, 6 is in the lateral portion of the eye, 4 is close to the eye. So 1, 2, 3 are within the nose, 4 is the junction between nose and cheek, 5, 6, 7, 3 of them are in the cheek. Then the next number 8, that is at the junction between the eyelid. So everything is junction. The fourth one is junction. Then 9, 10, 11 are on the eyebrow, upper eyelid. 9 is on the lateral portion of the eyebrow. 10 is in the middle of the eyebrow. 11 is in the medial portion of the eyebrow. 12, 13, 14 are medial to the eyebrow. 14 is in the center. 30 is in the center. So I always tell, while he called from 14 to 30, if you remove the teeth, the last molar and the front central incisor, if you count the tooth and between the tooth, tooth between the tooth, from 14 you will reach 30. So everything will come within this 30 in this Tessier's classification of this. Now, this completes my talk on the etiopathogenesis and what all form the craniofacial deformities. Now I'll go to new slide share. General principle indication approaches to synostosis and other craniofacial anomalies. This is what I see it, as I see it, not what is given in the book exactly. Now let us imagine how does the suture develop and grow. There is ectomeninx first. In that, islands of bones develop. This is occipital, this are parietal, these are the frontal. These islands of bone have the front which is called as the osteogenic front. That is the portion which are against each other. As it grows, the osteogenic front touches each other. So you see here this, osteogenic fronts go, touches against each other. Once there is pressure between the two osteogenic front, there is natural resorption taking place there in between. Once there is resorption, that area becomes weak and the brain starts pushing it as the brain grows. That opens up the osteogenic fronts. Then in between those, new bone is formed. This process keeps on going. And as the brain grows, the skull also grows, prevents the suture getting fused. The brain grows by 2 years, 75%, 900 cc of the brain. By 6 years, nearly 1060 is the volume, and 90% of the growth is completed. Then what is remaining? 10% only between 6 and 20 years of age. That shows the majority of growth takes place by 2 years of age. And if you are unable to do surgery at that time, then it is not going to be of great help. When you say the normal size, we call it as a normal cephalic index. You see here, roughly four, if we say 4.5 times of this, then 6 times in the anterior portion. So 4.5 divided by 6 into 100, 75 to 80% of the anterior posterior length, if the transverse width is there, then it is normal. So you can understand, if it is more, that means it is breaking. If it is less, it is going to be scaphocephalic. I'll come to that when we go there. When you look at this, there is a sagittal suture. As the sagittal suture, the same thing what I told happens. both these sides will start moving away from this, and there will be a transverse growth. When the sutures fuse early, less transverse growth takes place, and there is a compensatory anterior posterior growth. You can see here. So anterior posterior grows transversely, it doesn't grow. That is why we call it a scapotaphyly or boat shape. If the metopic suture gets fused, the transverse diameter of the frontal area gets affected, and you call that as trigonocephaly or metopic synostosis. When there is a coronal suture, that suture helps for an anterior posterior growth. If it gets fused, you get a short skull or brachycephaly. If it is unilateral, you call it as frontal brachycephaly. If it is bilateral, you call it as bicoronal. Same thing happens in lambda. It can be occipital plagiocephaly. If every one of them are fused, you got a pancranial synostosis. What are the steps of surgery? This is only general. I'm not going to talk on anything specific. The basic principle is release the synostotic suture, reshape the calvarium to correct the secondary deformity which has happened. Because of the abnormality, the brain pushes the weaker portions of the skull. Yes?
Okay, yeah.
Anything?
I know, I understand, yeah.
Any problem, Radha?
Okay. Where are you in Arapuram? No. Where are you in Arapuram, which place?
Radha Krishnan?
Just a minute, sir. Yes, sir.
Your mic is on.
Yes. Oh, sorry.
No, I thought you said something. So reshape the calvarium and correct the secondary deformity. Reshape the artery. Reposition. And in the mid-third correction, osteotomy or distraction as is here. These are all based on three principles of this year. That is, orbits can be osteotomized and moved without causing blindness. Cranial bones can be osteotomized, stripped of periosteum, and repositioned and will still survive. Third principle, intra and extracranial approaches can be combined without undue risk of infection. If we analyze where is the problem, what is the problem, we can solve most of them logically. If the anterior posterior dimension is short, you have to undo onset. If the lateral dimension is short, you have to expand it. If the height is more, you have to reduce it. If there is excess, we resect it. If deficient, you add it. So basically, the maneuvers are resection, augmentation, either with bone graft or implants, whatever is required, or advancement, flattening, or expansion, all in one, in different places. This is the basis. So it requires adequate exposure, requires osteotomy, requires reshaping, grafts, and finally, immobilization. What is the position? If you want anterior up to the cortex, it is supine. If you want the occiput and the vertex, it is prone. If you want from one end to the other, the best way to do this is prone with a neck extended with a support. Now what I have decided over here is a very simple one. Without a ring, just take a tower, fold it on the side for that patient. After the patient comes to theater, after he is intubated, you take a tower, fold it according to that width, that what is required. As you can see here clearly, from opposite to front, I was able to access by just simple this technique. I almost put seal it off. We take it down so that you can paint it. I put take it down to the endotracheal tube also so that you paint it. It's so compromised on something which is semi-sterile, partially sterile, everything is sterile. Infiltration and then zigzag trichophytic incision and trichophytic closure. That is, you make a zig incision and the knife is actually slanting. You can see here, this is the only place where it is slanting. Slanting parallel to the hypothalamus. And you close it, the amount of chances of the scar we see is almost not there. You can see here, you don't see the scar. Normally, otherwise, the biparietal incision scar, biparietal incision scar shows up. Here, it is one of the best way of concealing is zigzag incision and trichophytic closure. Then you dissect it. Nowadays, we take the see supraorbital nerve and preserve it. As you see, you you must remember the final suture line should rest on bony support once the advancement is complete. That means if it is unsupported, more chance of dehiscence taking place. So it should be supported. So we plan it that way. You can see here. I normally measure the forehead and alter the bar position accordingly so that if I have to turn it around, it forms a nice forehead. So I measure which side will be good for forehead, whether it is a superior portion, if I turn it down, then it may get a better forehead than the inferior portion. Then I plan our accordingly of the measurement. If you feel you can even leave a strip of bone around the sagittal sinus, I can take it in two pieces when it is required or when there is a danger. In your CT, you feel that it is adherent, and it is very close, or it is dangerous, or you are working with the neurosurgeon who is new to this. Then it is much safer to go this way and then nibble this area and then take it as a separate piece. You must beware of the middle cranial fossa. When you look like this, you see here, when there is a severe shortage in coronal synostosis, you find the middle cranial fossa, the temporal lobe, burrows underneath into the armlet. So if you cut this, you have got every chance of injuring the temporal lobe. Therefore, you have to make a separate burrow where you find there is so much of narrowing or shortage of the anterior cranial fossa better for you to make a drill hole separately bar and then connect this and then cut it, protecting the dura. Then depending how much you want, you can include portion of the nose, portion of the nose, the entire nose and the orbit, or entire thing along with the floor of the orbit. Second incision is subciliary. If you feel that you are unable to reach through the microcoronal the floor, or in the early cases, I also always used to do bicoronal. For safety's sake, you can make the section of the infraorbital cut through the bicoronal, subciliary incision as you see here. Then the intraoral incision wherever it is required. Now with 3D model available, already you can plan it with the 3D model. You can cut it and practice. See how it is anticranial fossa. How deep you feel is your cribriform plate of ethmoid, so that you will be able to choose your subplate length and also bar hand position. You could see here in the cephalic index is 54.46. That means so much it is anterior posteriorly formed. With the help of the same 3D model, what I have planned. You can see here the pieces, what we have planned. Same thing can be planned and taken off. It can be bent. All these are possible when you are doing it by 9 months or 1 year of age. If it is beyond two, sometimes it is very tough. But otherwise, the real cuts, you can bend it as you want. Or even you can hammer it down. Then bone grafts, you can take it from the cullery itself, make a groove there on or around, and then once you reach the floor, you will be able to section and take off the bone from that area. Separating the nasal and the cranial cavity by, this is a case which combined, it is in workshop by himself and Dr. Sharma. The pericranial flap which we take and then we cover and separate the cranial cavity from the nasal cavity, which is important when you have an approach which exposes both. Then fixation is done. Olden days we used to do it with stainless steel wires, augmenting it. Then we start moving towards plates and screws made of titanium. Then we started using the biodegradable material. A small point I would like to tell you. Some of you may feel that it is very expensive. Not only it costs around 80,000 rupees or 1 lakh for you, only for this material, if you are using them. But there's a trick when you can't afford. What I do is I buy only the wire, this mesh, cut it into a plate, whichever way I want. And then I use the titanium screw. So after all, this has to disappear. The titanium screw has no role to play. It will remain as is. So by that combination, because each screw costs you about nearly 3,000 rupees. So instead of that, you can use this with a titanium. Don't tell I told this. See here, fixations. Now something called as a Sony build, which is an ultrasound. You have an implant pins. Put the pin in and activate his own equal, through the ultrasound, you will find that disappears into the crevices made by this screw. Initially, you are drilling it, the little bit side holes also gets filled with this material so that it is very firm. So you got an activator there. This is an handpiece. You can see here. One, two, three, four. When you are activating, switch. For you to then you got to the bench work and then put back the same thing and then artificial dural is available now in case required. The dural repulses extensive that can be used. Something called as a flow seal. Sometimes the bleed is more from the deep low, and the child's weight is low, and you feel that it's excess bleeding. You can use this, it arrests the bleeding considerably. We must all remember the bleeding continues for nearly 48 hours. And of course, I use sometimes the glue for the dural repair also. You have to follow the case from the small age. Well, up to here, good on. The follow-up is necessary. Serially taking the X-ray are also a clinical photograph. See ya. Thank you very much. I suppose I gave you a short, or not short, a lengthy idiopathogenesis and also the craniofacial anomalies, what are the different types, and how do you go about the general principle of exposure, cutting, and then molding, and then fixing of the bone. Each one of them, sagittal, coronal, and hypertelorescent, and the trauma, craniofacial trauma, Professor Ramesh Sharma of Chandigarh will be speaking to you from tomorrow, same time. You have any questions? I'll be too happy. You've got another 10 minutes left.
Anyone with questions, please?
None.
Well, I think this is a very high-flown topic to a basic plastic surgeon, sir. I don't know how many of them really deal with this particular area.
No, I think this is something we wanted to do it for the kindle the interest for them to do it. It's not a high flown. I think it is part and parcel of plastic surgery. And I think many people have to take it up. And we have been advocating this for the past nearly about 10 to 15 years, this topic. And we thought that we must take this beyond 5 or 6 centers which are regularly doing, because our patient needs this type of surgery, and we need people to get interested and get trained.
Sir, hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, I am Shusharan from Guwahati, sir. Sir, how many teaching centers are there in India who deal regularly with craniofacial anomalies, sir?
See, the point is this: you will have to go and work in a center which is also doing, not for 2 months or 3 months, it is difficult. Because on an average in a month, you may get 2 cases. On an average, a really busy craniofacial surgeon does about maximum 15 to 20 of synostosis. Other things we do more. So to get training like that, you've got to work at least for 1 year in some of these places. I can say, I think Chandigarh is one of the very busy centers, PGI. And I do on an average about 1 to 2 a month. Maybe I can say about 15 to 20 I do in a year. But I have slowed down, and there are people in Amrita, the maxillofacial surgeon is doing, and in Bangalore, there are about 5 or 6 really active centers in Mumbai.
It has really grown into a subspecialty, sir, a super specialty.
I don't know what you call us, what is called this people.
Like general.
Irony of English is, what is sub is super. Sub is so English is a funny language, I think, yeah. I think it is a, I would call it as a subspecialty, because you must remember this way. I'm one of the few who was a self-trained guys. So if I can do it, you can do it. I think that's the way I'll cut it.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello, Dr. Sridhar.
Yes, sir.
This is Ramesh Sharma from Chandigarh.
Yes. Yes, Ramesh.
Yeah. It was a very nice presentation by Dr. Sridhar. And as one of the participants said that, you know, there are very few centers which are doing these kind of surgeries. I think that part is partly correct. The important thing is that all the plastic surgeons should know that this kind of surgery can be done. They may not necessarily do the hardcore surgery, but the principles of craniofacial surgery can be applied in our day-to-day plastic surgery practice. And that should be our emphasis when we are addressing the general plastic surgery crowd. So tomorrow onwards, when I will take over, my effort will be that we show you the techniques without scaring you, giving you confidence that this surgery can make a difference to the lives of the patients. And that is why some of us have to take it up full time, and others can take it up partly, just employing the craniofacial techniques in their day-to-day plastic surgery practice. So if that message is conveyed, I think that is what we want to do.
Thank you. You see, maxillofacial trauma you are doing, you are going to extend it beyond that little. So little at a time, you have to move. You are doing maxillofacial, then you do orbit. From orbit, you are doing anteracranial fossa, frontocranial advancement. Not necessary, you must straight away jump to hypotyloid. So I think that is the way you have to progress. One step at a time, but definitely take a step forward.
True. I agree with you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Welcome.
Thank you. And welcome, Professor Sharma, to this platform. And we'll be starting at 12 o'clock tomorrow.
Okay.
Thanks, everyone. And I shall end the meeting on this note.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.